Live.
Let me try that again. Good afternoon.
Hey.
Refresh your browsers, y'all, because today is Monday.
Yes.
March 26, 2012. And you're listening to Room 3026 live.
See, a rolled-up newspaper. This is where your rolled-up newspaper needs to be.
This is episode 494.
There we go.
A 60-minute conversation ranging from technology to pop culture.
Frequently all points in between.
And I'm your host, Damon Nollan. We are broadcasting live.
Live.
Right here in Durham, North Carolina. It is lunch hour.
In
the Onyx Tower.
The Onyx Tower.
Today, my co-hosts are Mr. Derek Brinson.
The world's funkiest man. Stay funky, my friends.
And Michael Render.
Doozy.
And as always, we encourage listener participation. That means that you can join the conversation. All you have to do is call this number, 646-929-2689.
646-929-2689.
Or you can chat with us right here in the chat room.
Come on.
Go to blogtalkradio.com/Damond Nollan. Click on today's episode. Scroll to the bottom. And there we are.
Typically, if you're joining us live, you might have to click on that red on-air banner. Yeah.
That's it. Want to give a special thanks to Mr. Darren Tyler for providing our theme song. It's called Without You.
It is clearly funky and head nodinous.
Which reminds me that without you, we would not be where we are today. So let me say thank you. We really do appreciate it. Let me turn to the chat room and say hi to those who are walking in the room
What's up?
Now. Of course, I want to say what's up to Alan Tran. He is my Lego man.
I'm his Lego fan.
Want to say what's up to LL, also known as Leon Lewis. We know him as Dyslexic and American in the chat room, but
Oogie.
We know who he is.
Sure.
We got our brother from the north, Mr. Ego Ant. That's Aaron Clifford. Welcome to the show, sir. And the one and only Miss Eileen Smith.
Who we love.
To have all of you. It is Monday, a beautiful Monday. I look outside right now. It's a little windy, a little windy. But you know what, though? I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
Because, you know, last week we were complaining about this, you know, this dusting of pollen on everything. And we had some good storms this weekend that hopefully washed a great deal of that out of the air and onto the ground where it can do good, like fertilize stuff. Right?
Yeah, more or less.
Yeah. So anyway, that's what's happening outside. I want to welcome you guys to this episode. Let me tell you what we're going to talk about in this episode.
Oh, do tell.
In the first segment, we're going to begin by talking about a new service that Groupon just launched on the 19th. It's called Groupon Scheduler. This could be huge.
Oh, do tell.
For women who
we like women.
May use this service. And I have some interesting news on this. We're going to talk about that shortly. We're also going to talk a little bit about social television and the latest buzz around the season premiere of Mad Men that came out last night. Got some new information on that, so you're going to want to stick around.
That was quite the social media buzz.
That's right. And I have the numbers on just how big of a buzz that really was. I made a rhyme there. Buzz, it really was.
Buzz, that was.
There's that and much more in this episode of Room 3026 Live. Yes, Ego Ant says from the chat room, man, y'all are pushing episode 500. Can you believe it?
For real.
500 episodes.
I was just thinking that.
Wow. That sounds like so many episodes. I mean, can you imagine how many we've done together? 500 episodes almost?
500.
Does it feel like 500 almost episodes to you? I mean, when you think back over the 500 episodes.
Yes.
Come closer, Mike. Come closer.
It does.
Come closer. I want you to just come closer to me.
No, wait till we get to 500.
You know, this is probably, and I tell you this, if it's anything like blogging, this is a huge thing. I mean, I think pretty much every single day during a weekday for however many years, it's like 2 years, something like that.
Yep.
That we've done this. That's an accomplishment, gentlemen.
Yeah.
And it's one that not many people can say that they've done.
I wonder how many episodes the people that start doing these blog talk radio shows. I wonder how we stack up. I wonder about the longevity of others who may have started.
Yeah.
He just didn't.
I know of like one who I think he was like over 5 years in. You know, so we're there, and of course I don't know how many episodes he's done, and I don't know if you can compare that episodes to somebody else's episode. I might look into that. Maybe there's something there.
Well, and
you know, just wondering.
The thing is, we do a week daily thing, and and some of the others are just do 1 day during the week. So
wow.
That's a big.
To me, it's a big. 500 is still a big thing.
Yeah, I mean, no doubt.
That's a big number.
That every weekday. Gosh, we've been that would by my math. We've been at this about a year and a half or so.
And I think it's it's almost 2 years. May 3rd.
500 is closer to 600, and then yeah. We're 52 weeks out. We're closer to our second birthday.
Yep.
Wow.
Yep. Miss Eileen says maybe I should bake a cake. Sweet.
If I knew you were coming.
Ego Ant says I can't even get my first episode done, and y'all talking about 500. You know, I mean, this is exciting. So thank you guys again. This really is I think the success of even getting here is due to a great extent because of you, because you're there with us, you know, each and every single day. It not that we would stop talking to each other, but it just wouldn't be the same without you. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
It wouldn't be the same.
Yes.
And I definitely look forward to getting on the air with you guys and just sharing this hour. One day at a time.
Yeah.
So thank you guys. This really is a celebration of all of us, and maybe we need to do something to bring some attention to that. So it's up to you. Thank you, and thank you. All right. So it's 7 minutes in. How about we jump right on into our first story?
Come on.
All right.
Feed Watch.
Thank you. That's pretty much what we're going to call this.
Well, we've been calling it that for almost 2 years, so no sense changing now.
Feed Watch. What is Feed Watch?
Feed Watch is where we constantly comb the blogs so that you don't have to.
I should know this after 2 years.
We give you the news that you can use because, well, that's what we do.
So,
you best not snooze. You will not lose.
No one likes losing.
Unless, of course, you just like singing the blues.
Losing is the only thing worse than singing the blues. Well, second only.
Sure, it works. All right, so we're going to
be North Carolina basketball fans singing the blues.
Which, yeah. I really wanted to take a little stick and go, take that.
Well,
but it's really quiet here, so yeah. I'll enjoy the silence.
Gloriously quiet. Yes.
I'll enjoy the silence because it's refreshing.
Was show valor in the face of my pack. They will be back. And Carolina cheated in the ACC tournament.
So State lost too then?
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
I didn't know that.
How are we cheating?
I didn't know that.
You know how they cheated. Two words for you. Lenny Wirtz.
Hey.
You know who he is. Doggone right, you know who he is. It's a striped shirt. If you know the name of one of the striped shirts, you know there's something wrong.
Hey. Everybody has to be on the opposite end of that at some point in time.
Yep. And today's your day.
Yeah, fair 2 weeks ago though.
It don't matter. Happened. Today's your day.
Yeah, I know. So
you were number one.
How are we number one?
Your team was number one, weren't they?
Nope.
Oh, okay. Well, Kentucky beat them either way.
Yeah.
Dun, 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 dun.
All right. It was Kansas, by the way.
Yeah, Kansas. What I meant to say. It's IK. Man,
who beat Duke?
UK.
The high school team.
I don't care.
See.
Right. I don't care.
Hey, man.
All right. So let's move on to our story, shall we? So let's talk about this new service that Groupon has just released. Well, actually, it was on the 19th of March, but still, it's a relatively new release, and it's come out in beta. It's called the Groupon Scheduler, and I want to give it to you guys real quick, Mike.
Yeah.
Pause. if you go to this link, okay, it's called groupon.com/scheduler. Groupon.com/schedule. I'm going to share this link with you guys in the chat room, but if you're listening on an archive show, I want you guys to see this for yourself.
What's up?
And I want to get your thoughts about this new service that they are rolling out for companies I shouldn't even limit it to just folks who are using Groupon. But if you are a company and you are using Groupon for your company or for a service, this new service here, Groupon.com/scheduler, is very, very interesting. Okay, so let me tell you about a little bit of what it is. It is essentially an online calendaring system that allows your business, if you're a spa, I don't know, a yoga studio, a hair salon, your contractor, photographer, anybody who may want to schedule some time for clients or customers to come in, okay? You can use this service to do that. And really, this is not, and again, this is not just for folks who use Groupon at all, but this is for anybody who has a business who wants to do some scheduling online. You can actually use this. Now, today, it is a free service. It doesn't cost you anything at all. You can get up there, put your business in,
well,
and
you know,
then
if that weren't the
create
case,
this account.
If it were not a free service, I'm fairly sure we wouldn't be talking about it that much.
Yeah, you're right. At least it wouldn't have got it wouldn't have received as much of an attention from me.
I'm so sure.
Right?
Yeah.
No surprises there. That, you know, interesting enough, that is becoming a brand for me. I ain't trying to pay. One day I'm going to come up with a blog or something. It's going to be called IaintTryingToPay.com.
Talk about all the ways,
right?
Things
all,
you get,
all the things that you can get for free across the web.
Right. Only free for me.
Right? Tim Arthur is in the room. What's going on, Tim? So anyway, if you click on that link there, I want to show it to you just so you can kind of get a sense. Yeah, click on that one. It's open to all merchants, right? And you can see the calendar system here. And
it's on
the
MacBook.
Oh, gosh, I know.
Stop hating.
I know.
Stop hating. It's so unbecoming.
But you can book your customers online.
Oh, and you can see like where they are. On the Google Maps.
That's right. You can manage your schedule as a business, so you know who's coming to your business and where not.
Yeah.
And you can essentially watch how many appointments you've had.
Role.
Right.
Okay.
You have reports, right? How many people are scheduling your service? Blah blah blah. It's a very interesting service. And it is open to all merchants, not just those who use the Groupon deal, okay? But anyway, this is the baby of Groupon, who purchased OpenCow, and they're essentially using that to provide this service, okay? And but what's interesting about this, and the first article that got my attention was talking about the power of women and how 77% of its income that Groupon gets from its customers are coming from the female consumer base. 77%. One of the things that they were making an argument in this article was this, that men are better at networking, but women are much better at collaborating. And these kind of tools, like this one, this scheduler tool, is so much better. And another thing that they brought up as well is that women, you know, tend to sort of manage a lot of the household stuff. I don't know how true that is where you are, but women tend to really manage the household, whether it's paying bills, right? The dude brings home the bacon and she pays the bills, for example. Or she manages when certain services are going to come to the house. So however that works, right?
Right.
Anyway, so having this tool where you could essentially organize when you are going to have a hair appointment, or get your nails done, or have maybe the lawn guy come out and cut your grass. Or the one I saw last week is a power washer to come out to your house. And you can schedule that via the online service, which is something different. So if you go to Groupon, I guess the idea here, you go to Groupon, you see this deal that you like, you click on it and say, okay, I've purchased the deal, like this power washer, but when can he come? Well, now you don't have to call him. You can just say, hey, I want to schedule you guys to come out during this time. And the organization of the business can then say, these are the available slots that I have, and I can come to your house. And you can do all that online without having to make a telephone call.
So that's that. So, okay.
So that's kind of a really neat tool.
I mean, that's kind of assuming that both parties are using the same system, yes?
Yes.
Okay, so that means...
If you were the, and again, this is a Groupon company that we're talking about, or a Groupon, a company that's using Groupon to sell its a deal.
Okay.
Right? So yeah, if they do that, then you can manage it this way. And I think that's a neat idea.
Yeah, sure. And it may very well help to get more users on into the system. Might not, but, you know, it's a good shot.
So if you can, here's the thing. There are two big questions that have come from this. I just wanted to see what they were saying, but there are two big questions that come from this, right? Are you ready? Question number
one. You
got
a mouse?
Well, it's easier to see. You got this big, gigantic screen, so I was trying to see.
All right.
I'm looking at the notes.
Mm-hmm.
Question number one, who owns the data? If it's you, the user, and here's the question, right? Because if you are a customer and you go here and you schedule your appointment with said company, say power washer company A, and I give you my contact information and all my details, who's going to own the information? Will it be Groupon or will it be the business? Question number two, how does this affect your current customers? Now, let me explain what that means. So if you are a hair salon or you're a spa or whatever service that you're running where you would even need an appointment calendar like this, if you are already making appointments with your customers and this is automated online and all these Groupon customers now jump online and start scheduling your time using this service, the first observation is, A, this is a discounted cost, right? Because typically that's what you're doing with Groupon. You're providing a discounted service. So instead of providing the full price service to your customers, let's say getting your hair done, you're now giving preference to discounted users over your current regular customers who are paying full time.
Yes.
Secondly, your current customers may not be using the web at all. They may be making telephone calls via the web, via the old service. Hey, I want to come in next week, which means now the discounted service people are going to jump in and take all the early stuff, leaving your regular customers out in the cold. That's another question that has come up. So there's two questions there, and right now it's not entirely clear with this new service whether or not Groupon is going to allow you to get that data or how this is going to work, because it's almost especially with question number two being how does that displace your current customers. Now you could probably do things like put in sort of like pre-populate or hold some spots for your regular users, like let me leave a couple spaces for them and them only, and that becomes sort of a manual process, which is kind of not very good.
Yeah.
So that's definitely one option, but that's probably not good for Groupon because they want to sell as many seats as they can online. So there's kind of just some big questions that are coming across this particular service. But overall, I think that this idea is a good one, and I think that this is really going to help some of these businesses who may want to sort of automate more versus saying call me, and then kill my telephone or my email, and then come use this service. I think this really may provide a really needed push to some of those people. So anyway, you can go get the whole thing over groupon.com/scheduler, groupon.com/scheduler to jump on board. Okay, so let's move on to the Mad Men social TV buzz that happened last night. Now, I see Tim Arthur is in the room right now. And Tim Arthur last night, and you guys may have heard about this, he threw a party, a Mad Men party last night.
I did not.
At his house. And it was pretty interesting, because you get there and he had his wife, who is an outstanding homemaker, a beautifully decorated home, laid out a spread of meatballs and Triscuits, which I guess is a treat from the 60s. I don't know. I've always enjoyed them. Some cheese, some Utz, which I guess are better than nuts. Chips Desserts. And pretzels. And Tim, who was hosting this event, got some freebies from the Mad Men, I guess, company or show. He got some posters, got some masks that are on these little fan sticks. What do you call those things? Like little masks, like the Star Wars masks that they take the eyeballs out.
What are you talking about?
They're paper masks.
Oh yeah,
on a stick. Whatever you call those, right?
Dim, yeah.
He had some of those.
Okay.
He got some posters.
Like masquerade masks.
Well, no. They're not like masks you put on. They're just like masks that you hold on a stick. Yeah. Right. So different characters. And I'm having flashbacks of my Star Wars days, because that's pretty much where I last used them. I used to walk around with little Star Wars, like, hey, I'm Luke Skywalker, the original Luke Skywalker from the 1970s. Mind you. Anyway, he had those. He had a t-shirt. They had had that. He also had a what do you call those? Not a flask, but a shaker, like a cocktail shaker.
Oh yes.
He had one of those, and he got some napkins and other goodies. So anyway, he threw a party last night, and we went there about 7, got some good food, ate up, got 8, enjoyed that. 8 o'clock, we watched the final season of season 4. The final episode of season 4 to kind of catch up.
I say whoa.
And then we went into at 9 o'clock, started watching the premiere episode. So I want to give a quick shout out to Tim Arthur, man. Appreciate you throwing that together, man.
That's cool.
Yeah, he did a great job. And his house is perfect for just kind of doing these kind of things, because it's like so comfortable. These couches make you want to go to sleep, and his wife just totally decorates. Now, Mike, you've been to his house before, haven't you?
Yes.
So you know what I'm talking about. Yes. It's kind of an old country, I don't know, rustic kind of design. And it's all the way through her house, and it's awesome. Anyway, so I want to talk about the buzz from last night, okay? And I got some numbers here from Bluefin Labs. You know, this is the same company that did, like, the Grammy Awards and the Super Bowl. And they kind of gave us some numbers on just how popular or what kind of buzz this created. And I got some numbers that I want to share with you. So number one, as I open this up, number one, and you can go to bluefinlabs.com to get this as well, and I'll show the URL with you in just a moment. But so yesterday, the premiere, there were 106,000 comments made last night about this premiere show. There were 67,000 commenters who made obviously a number of comments. As far as the breakdown of the gender, 52% male, 48% female. That's pretty close. Yep. I mean, and last night we had two women in there, four guys, as far as in this party. The overall sentiment of the event was 33% positive, 57% neutral, and 10% negative. Now, as far as the highlights, I'm looking at this now. The biggest, I guess, spike in this, and I'm gonna, matter of fact, let me go ahead and share this URL with you right now, so you guys can see for yourself what I'm looking at. If you click on that, you'll see that the biggest spike was really at the beginning of the show. It's when this big hype was like, "Oh my gosh, it's about to begin!" And then it jumps up to the highest point in the entire show. The other point where it got a lot of the largest other spike in this was when Don's wife performs Zooby Zooby Zoo. Is anyone familiar with that? Have you heard that song before? Derek, you look like somebody who might know that song. Zooby Zooby Zoo.
It rings a bell, but I don't want to say that I am familiar.
Here, let me play a little bit for you, shall I?
Do that.
Zooby Zooby Zoo. Zooby Zooby Zoo. Zooby Zooby Zoo. Zooby Zoo. Zooby Zoo. Mon Dieu, qu'ils sont doux. Zooby Zooby Zoo.
Yeah.
Zooby Zooby Zoo. Zooby Zooby Zoo. Zooby Zoo. Zooby Zoo. Le bruit des bisous.
All right. So anyway, that's the song last night that got a lot of attention. Matter of fact, we were singing it in the party last night, and it was such a catchy tune that it was really the
it reminds me of that old
selling point.
Reminds me of the Friday song. That's what it reminds me of.
Zooby Zooby Zoo.
No, it reminds me of like something from that the space age 60s bachelor movies, like your boy Mike Myers.
Goldfinger, what do you call
it?
Who's
that character that he did?
Yeah, I know you're talking about. What's his name? Oh man, just
I'm
like
not,
it slips
not
my
helping.
Mind. No,
not
clearly you're not.
I'm not helping.
Have you even seen any of that movie, the Goldfinger one with the?
Yeah, I've seen them both of them.
What's the name of the character?
Crazy, you got it.
Yeah, thanks, Mike.
You got Beyonce in it and everything.
Yeah, helpful.
Quincy Jones wrote the original verse or wrote the theme music. Come on, Derek.
Help a brother out. Anyway, I want to give you a comparison.
Yeah, baby.
Yeah, that's the one.
What's his name?
I'll tell you in a second. I got the Wikipedia.
Well, you can just go
to
the. If you just go to Austin Powers, thank you.
Ah.
All you have to do is ask the group. I mean, they'll
tell
you.
Ask them.
Yeah, just ask the team. They'll tell you.
You have to wait 30 seconds for the answer.
Well, not necessarily. Anyway, oh, behave, baby.
That neo late 60s bossa nova bachelors in space kind of stuff. Yeah. I love that stuff, just for the record.
So kind of in comparison to some of the other shows that have come on television, so we're talking about social media comments, how many comments were made. We were at 106,000 comments made during the season 5 premiere of Mad Men. Let's put that in comparison against Alcatraz. Alcatraz is that television show on Fox. It brought in its season premiere.
Alcatraz recently? You know, as a tourist.
Thank you. Cool. Appreciate it.
Yeah.
Did you see any characters from the past showing up?
No. There was a nifty tour, but yes. Actually, they made strong mention of some of them, the Birdman, and so, which I didn't know was in the actual Alcatraz show, but we're just now on the series.
Well, if you compare the season premiere of Alcatraz, that was 43,000 to 106,000. Okay, so there's a big difference. Whoa. There. Yeah, that's a big difference. Smash, the other sort of the show that has on NBC. What's the girl's name? A happy birthday to you, Mr. President.
You're talking about Marilyn Monroe.
Thank you. We might be good at some good board games, you and I. Happy birthday to you, Mr. President.
Derek won't get it.
Yeah. Anyway, that Smash is about some characters who are trying to play Marilyn Monroe on Broadway. Anyway, the season premiere for that show, which also got quite a few buzz points, came in at 52,000, which still is far beneath the 106,000. And then there's another show I've never heard of called Good Christian Bells on ABC. What? That one came out, its premiere came at 21,000. So clearly the point is this did fairly well, very well. It didn't beat the Grammys or the Super Bowl, clearly, but still it did fairly well. What I find interesting, and I think Tim and I, we've had this discussion about social TV, but what I find interesting is that this is a new metric that you are going to see in entertainment, right? That people, these companies are beginning to look to Twitter and other places to determine how popular is our show, because now they can tell throughout the show where people are talking and engaging with the content. And when you look at the Super Bowl, for example, you can see the peaks and valleys of how well it did. And at the end of the Super Bowl, where they were down to the few minutes of the game, that's also a very high point when people were talking. So it's going to be interesting to see how these entertainment companies are going to look at social television. I look at these networks to kind of get a feel for how well their product is doing, and that may change to some extent how the show actually, you know, changes or how it's written. I don't know. I want to go to the phones. I see that Dyslexic in America is calling in. I want to say what's up to him. What's going on, Dyslexic in America LL?
What's up? I just wanted to give everybody an interesting statistic that I've noticed for myself. I started using Pinterest for Dyslexic in America.
Uh-huh.
And it has driven the traffic up to my site by 10%.
Uh-huh.
But not only that, I went from 5 new subscribers a week to 50 over the last 2 weeks.
Wow.
I don't understand it, but it seems to
You know, you're the second person that's told me that.
Okay, I just thought the people would be interested in how much traffic and exactly people who are interested in this topic it will drive to your site.
Pinterest is just magic, and no one gets it. It just boosts your traffic. There we go.
Yeah.
Well, greatly. My assumption is that you're putting good pictures out there.
Well, you know, I have one topic, so it's just different. There are blogs I write about people with dyslexia who are artists and stuff, so I put their work up there.
Cool.
And then I point it back to the site. But, you know, quality is, I guess, in the eye of the beholder.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Well, so what is it, I guess I'm looking for yours now. What is it, What is your account listed under? I want to see what you're putting out
Dyslexic
there.
Dyslexic in America.
Okay, I just typed that in. Maybe it's all like one username or something. Let me see. Let me see if it shows up. I'm doing a quick search on Pinterest to see if I can find you or your boards, and I'm not seeing it. Anyway, so...
No, hold on. Maybe. I'll put it in the chat room real quick.
Okay, cool. But yeah, man, great job. Yeah. And so there you go. If you're not yet using it, maybe now's the time.
Yeah, I just thought everybody would be kind of interested in that number. Get on it. I don't know what it does, and I don't know how it works, but.
But get on it either way.
Clearly.
Yeah, just get on it. It can't hurt.
Cool. I appreciate that, sir. And I'll take a look at it once you post the link there.
Indeed.
All right, cool.
Cool. All right. There you go. Pinterest.
Yes.
You heard it here first. All right, so let's take a break. And after the break, we're going to take a look at the latest comment from Facebook's stance on this whole passwords from employers or employers asking for passwords. I got a new comment made by Facebook. I want to get your thoughts on that. Also, we'll take
this drama, how it's playing out.
It's everywhere.
It brings up some really important questions that need to be asked.
Absolutely. Then after that, we're going to take a look at Google. Is the autocomplete an invasion of your privacy? That's the question we're going to take a look at after we go to Daily Booth. So pull out your cameras, y'all. Let's see what you're doing. We're going to Daily Booth.
What are you doing? What are you wearing?
All right. Daily Booth is where we go to take pictures. It's a free website. You can go there right now. It's www.dailybooth.com. Pull out your webcam, pull out your cell phone, or you can just upload a picture, whatever is easiest for you. And once you do, you can share that with us right here in the chat room. And also, if you're listening, but we're not yet following each other, well, if you follow me first, I'm at Damon Nollan. And I'll follow you back. Let me know you are a Room 3026 Live listener.
Live.
All right. Cool. Okay, so let's see here. I see Mike's pulling out his camera. And while Mike is posting that picture, I am looking at Dyslexic in America's his Pinterest page. I clicked on that link there. And yeah, there are some really good pictures here. Dyslexic Chef, Dyslexic Artist. These are some of the names of his boards. He has 9 boards. Dyslexic Architects, Dyslexic Fashion Design. But you have some really good pictures. I guess my question now becomes, are all of these going back to your blog? All these pictures that you have? And if so, I mean, I can clearly see why. I mean, there's some good pictures. I see a picture of Beyonce under Fashion Design. Let me click on one and see where it goes. There's one of Beyonce, of a fashion designer. I click on that, and that one doesn't go anywhere. But I can see you got some good pictures. It's not like it's not just graphs and stuff. It's the real life pictures. Man, good stuff, man. Congratulations on that, by the way.
Indeed.
Tim Arthur throws a picture up, and he throws up the thumb. What's up, man? Happy Monday.
Miss Eileen.
He says.
In the place to be.
Miss Eileen throws one up and says, swag from AWeber and invitation to their headquarters.
Really?
Sweet.
Yes.
Where is AWeber anyway? Where is AWeber located?
Good question.
Is that anywhere near you? I'm just wondering. I mean, because I got eye contact right down the street from us, so that's right. That was a plus. I don't know where AWeber is, but, you know, if they want to fly me out there, you know. I'll take it.
I missed them if they were in Silicon Valley. They missed my glorious Silicon Valley tour a couple of weeks back. They show.
Miss Marianne enters the room. I see Miss. Mrs. Marianne. Let me start there because, you know, there is a mister. I want to say thank you, Marianne, for joining us.
In Pennsylvania, just like Miss Eileen is.
Oh, that there. Okay, there you go.
You should go.
There you go. No.
Roll up and say, hey, you know.
Well, maybe when I do some traveling and I happen to go out of town, then maybe that'll work. Yeah.
No, I was talking to Miss Eileen.
Well, of course, she should go.
That's what
it's right there where she is. Absolutely. Well, but if I'm know, saying if I want to go.
Pennsylvania's a big place, so it might not be that all that close. But
well, that's true.
Hey, you guys know me.
That's true. No, that's true. You're right. You're right. All right. So feel free to post those pictures as you get them. No worries. No worries. I'm going to move on to just another comment that Facebook, a spokesperson from Facebook
said. I'm
going to
get my picture up in a second.
And it says Facebook says this: we don't think employers should be asking prospective employees to provide their passwords because we don't think it's the right thing to do.
That's wrong.
While we do not have any immediate plans to take legal action against any specific employers, we look forward to engaging with policymakers and other stakeholders to help better safeguard the privacy of our users. The way the article initially was written was that Facebook sort of takes a backwards step, right? So they were kind of aggressive on last week. What is this, Mike? Mike takes a picture of the Daily Booth with the jungle.
That's just plants.
That's pretty cool.
Yes, Mike is he's a witty fellow, isn't he?
But they were Facebook was very aggressive, you know, basically saying we're gonna get you guys if you continue to take potential employees or current employees' passwords.
Do that?
But that's the aggressiveness that was in their tone last week.
That is empty bravado,
right? Well, this week they sound very different. Like, hey guys, we're not okay. I know last week we said we were going to take you guys and sue you. Don't get mad. We're not going to do that yet, guys. Yeah, we're not going to do that yet. So in any case.
That's funny.
There
you know,
are
what I
there,
said when I was like all threatening and stuff. We didn't really mean
that. Yeah. Guys, continue to, you know, like... Come on, please advertise with us still. You're still
nice.
Your friends.
It'd be nice.
We're not going to sue you. We'll let you know first, right? We're going to let the U.S. courts, you know, do what they do. We're not going to push it.
Yeah.
But there are two senators. One we talked about, Richard Blumenthal from Connecticut. He said he was going to work on a bill that would potentially address this. But there's another one that I found out as well. His name is... Senator Leland Yee from California, and he said he's also going to work on a bill in his state that he'll push through the Senate to kind of get some control on that. So Facebook may not have to do it right now,
I'm
but they're
just
saying, hey.
I'm just wondering what kind of control anybody can exercise over what business decides they want to do with the potential employees.
Well, they're trying to make it, I guess, illegal. You know, to say, hey, you can't. That's wrong. That's you shouldn't do that.
Well, we all know it's wrong. Even right? They know it's wrong.
But maybe there's some protection that you would give to employees. It's kind of like, salary protection? Like there's minimum wage, right? There's a protection for that, and now we're having to say, hey, guys.
Yeah.
To protect you as a worker, you should not have to require someone's password to get a job, right? The new protected class, Facebook users.
Or to keep a job, but...
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay.
Ego Ant says from the chat room, Facebook to employers. We aren't going to sue you. We're going to undelete those party pics from last year and email them to all your employees. You know, the one where you were laying over sideways and drinking too much.
You were planking some... suggestive inanimate object.
Yeah. He continues to say a minimum privacy law. There you go.
You know, there is no minimum privacy law. This is United States of America. There is already a right to privacy. We don't need to legislate this.
You should not be able to get into my personal a Facebook account to get a job or to keep a job. So.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, the protection is screw you, I ain't working here no more.
Well, sure. And unless, of course, you're in a place where there are no other jobs now.
And most of us
are.
But.
If you say, if I came tomorrow and says, hey, Derek, there's a new thing I need to have. I need to have your login credentials for Facebook and all the other social networks. Oh, by the way, if you don't do it, pack your bags.
Oh.
You know, what...
Yeah,
you know?
that is jacked up. Well, being that you put it that way, man, there should be legislation required
to protect you.
Litigation.
Exactly.
Hey.
Exactly. Yeah, I need to know what you're doing.
Yes,
so
you do know what I'm doing.
Yeah.
Between the hours of 9 and 6.
But what happens afterwards? That may affect the kind of person that you are.
It does affect the kind of person that I am. But
that has no effect on anything else. That should concern anyone else.
Eileen says, there's no way that people are that desperate for work that they're going to give. I don't know.
I beg to differ.
The guy did it, right?
I beg to differ. I think this is...
That's why we're having this discussion, because a guy actually did it. I mean, in order to be recertified, he gave over his stuff because he thought that he kind of had to. And maybe he was in a position where he didn't have the money to be out of work for a while. I don't know. I don't know people's situation, yeah, but... I mean, yeah, don't fire me anytime soon, because I need the money.
This is a great question. Like I said, it kind of opens the door to other much bigger questions.
Mm-hmm.
Like that one that Ms. Eileen just posted. Are people that desperate for work? Truth of the matter is, probably so.
And maybe if you're not doing anything in there anyway, it probably wouldn't be a big deal. It's like, yeah, if you want it, go get it. But I just don't see why I would have to do that. It just seems wrong for me.
It's a matter of principle.
Yeah, like who do you think you are that you can get into my personal space?
I'm really looking at it in terms of a prospective employer that's going to require. That is a clear red flag that this is not the kind of place that I want to work.
Right. Miss Eileen asked the question, did he get the job? Well, I think he already had the job. This was just to be recertified.
Mm-hmm.
He was already working for the company, but he thought that if he didn't do it, that they might not recertify him again. And I think this was for the correctional and the correctional system, and they were checking to see if he had any gang affiliations.
I mean, truthfully, the point they were asking. Yeah, the way that it was the way that the situation was couched. It's a perfectly good reason for an employer to ask for an employee's personal business. It's just not legal in the America in which I grew up. That's all.
Right.
I mean, yeah, that's a really good reason.
Right. Yeah.
My employee in the criminal justice system as a prison guard should not have any gang affiliations or any untoward friendships with other prisoners at this or any other prison. But like I said, it's a great reason, but it's just not. It violates our individual rights to privacy. The government shouldn't be doing that, and employees should be forbidden from doing that. The last I checked, that's exactly the case.
And sometimes you just need a law in place to protect you.
I can live with that.
Right. So anyway, I'm sure that this is not the last we're going to hear. This is going to continue to roll out as time goes on. But I just wanted to give that latest update.
Glad you did.
On Facebook's stance. Let me move on to, since we are talking about invasion of your privacy, let's talk about something that is happening in Google's case.
What do you say?
Do no wrong, do no harm.
Don't be evil.
So, have you guys know about this autocomplete, right? You go into a Google search, you start typing something, and it immediately starts to put in some information to the end of your sentence or whatever you're typing. Mm-hmm. Well, there's a guy in Japan who says that Google is basically ruining his reputation. There was a Tokyo district court that is stopping, or has ordered Google to stop the autocomplete feature because it is, as this man says, it is an invasion of his privacy. Now, let me explain to you what's going on. So this guy's name, right? If you start typing this guy's name in, what happens is a number of crimes are being automatically attached to his name. So if you start typing whatever, I don't know his name, but whatever his name is, it starts to autofill like John Doe burglary in Tokyo or something crazy like that, right? So even though he's never done any of these crimes, people who may be using his name are finding like, dude, did you just, you know, murder somebody, or did you burglarize this latest bank?
Yeah, that was me.
I did that. So he's basically saying, look, Google, man, you got to turn this thing off because I can't get a job. These companies are like looking me up on the internet, and they're like, they're not returning my phone calls. Because John Doe robbed a bank last week in Tokyo. So this is the case. Now, Google says, okay, all right, look, we're not going to turn it off, just so you know. We are a U.S. company, and there's no Japanese law that's going to stop us from using what we're currently doing. But here's the point. This isn't an invasion of privacy. This is the stance that Google's taken. It's not an invasion of privacy because the search terms aren't manually created. There's nobody on the other end that's putting this in. But it's an algorithm that shows that what people are already typing in. These are popular search terms that people are using. And I don't know if you guys have done this, but I did it this morning. I started typing my name in just to see what would show up, right? So I went to Google. I started typing my name in, and I saw the words that came after. And you know, there's no surprises. I mean, there's no criminal act or anything like that. But I find it interesting. It sort of reveals what people think about you or what they're looking for you.
I want to know.
You probably got to go to Google.com directly and then try it. Yeah. What terms are showing up on your side when you do this?
I'm searching for you.
Well, I know what mine does. Well, mine's like a Picasso. The other one was just keep writing my name. Picasso was one, blog, NCCU. So you can see the top three. There's nothing there that, you know, that was like, oh man, it's crazy. But as you start typing, type NCCU, you'll see what NCCU shows up. You can see law, SGA, alumni, bookstore, right? But I think the first two are yours, the things that maybe you have searched in the past.
Entirely possible.
Right, because you have the remove button next to it. But this is interesting because if you've never done this before, it's kind of cool to see what people are typing a lot.
It could very well be what
behind your
what
name.
Mike typed, because he's the one that's logged into Google right now.
Or Mike, this is, yeah, things you look for. Either way, that's really interesting. So I wanted to share that with you. What do you guys think? Is this an invasion of privacy on your part?
Gosh, I'm hard-pressed to see this as an invasion of privacy per se. Yes, it is an inconvenience. It is even arguably unfair. But from the legal definition of invasion of privacy, that's tough case to make for me. If I were a lawyer, if I were a judge, knowing at least my interpretation of the law, I would say, get out of here. Sorry.
Yeah. And something in the chat room, I see you guys are chiming in. Egan Went says, I typed in Aaron is, and Google fills in awesome. I'm just saying, right? Go ahead. And you guys are funny, man. Tim Arthur says, well, you see personalized results, which is, no, I understand that. But we're talking about in the drop down of the search bar. This is even before you actually see the results on the page. This is what shows up as you type. And it kind of gives you some recommendations for things that you might finish that sentence with. So I don't know, I thought that was kind of cool. Someone says he is off his rocker. Tim says this guy is off his rocker. Really?
I think the guy that's trying to do this litigation because of the Google algorithm. That's
right.
Maybe that's a bit of an overreach.
Well, I guess
off his rocker
too. I mean,
I think, and
if these companies are like falling for it, like if they just go to Google search and says John Doe, and all of a sudden that must be you. And they don't even have any real comparison. We'd say, is this the same John Doe or somebody else? So, I mean, maybe you don't want to work for that company. If they're not looking beyond
well,
that.
Well, I think clearly it shows a misunderstanding of the technology and how it works.
Sure. I can see that.
And it also, for me, it suggests a very litigious behavior. If you're going to put forth a lawsuit over that, chances are that's not the first time you've you put out a really a bogus lawsuit.
Yeah.
I'm suing Google.
Tim says it's a money grab. It's a money grab. He's just trying to get some cash real quick. Be quiet. Sit down.
Nothing to see here.
Yeah. Keep it moving. All right. We're going to move on. We're going to go to a blog. We're also going to take a quick break. But after the break, we're going to take a look at there's a Windows versus Android challenge. And I want to give you the results of just how well one or the other did. So
imagine.
Let's go on to Blog Row.
If I were a guessing man.
And everyone knows you are.
Yes.
All right, let's go to Blog Row.
What did it look like? What are you wearing?
All right. Blog Row is when we take a look at what you guys are writing, what you're putting out there into the blogosphere. Today we have four stories that I can share with you. The first one comes from Basic Blog Tips. It's called Better Sidebars for Better Conversation. How does yours look? This one is written by Javon. And I think I'm following this dude on something else. I don't know. Anyway, he talks about those little sidebars on your webpage, you know, on like on the right hand side and left hand side.
Oh yeah.
And what he's basically saying is, if you know, do you have one, and how is it affecting your conversation or your conversion on your page? In some cases, it can be a distraction if you got too many things going on, right? Maybe you have that little newsletter sign up form, you got some links to go check out my Twitter handle, go check out this my Facebook page, and that may be in some cases taking away from getting them to the link that you want them to go through.
Yep, sure. Over your basic JavaScript overlays for a lot of services do the same thing for me. Man, they just make me crazy. I'm so out of there. Leave me alone. I came for something else.
Right. Well, and you know, and some of us, you know, are ADD, and you don't even get halfway through the article before you see something really cool on the right hand side or left hand side of your page. You're like, oh, let me go see this. Let me go click on that. Yeah.
Squirrel.
And you don't even come back later on to see the rest of the story. So the question is, you know, how is that working out for you? And I will say this much. He does say that I think he turns his off. Interesting. I want to get your thoughts on that.
And they lived happily ever after?
Right? I'd like to know about that. Eileen says, I have way too much stuff on my sidebar. I have begun to kind of cut mine down, though. I really have. I used to have a lot of stuff on the side, and I'm just like, dude, it's just too noisy. And so I'm trying to find a better way to kind of manage that and keep it simple. So anyway, I want to say thank you to Miss Eileen for sharing that story with us. If you haven't done so, go over there and check it out and leave a comment on her blog. We would appreciate that. There's another story that she's put out as well. This one comes from, I guess it's, I'm trying to figure out how to say this. I guess it's Merrick Verdi, another guy I think I'm following on something else. His is called Finding and Preparing to Start an Online Business. Finding and preparing to start an online business. There are some tips or some things to think about, rather, as you begin to kind of think up and move in that direction. I want to share this with you guys in the chat room as well. Do stop by and say hi and check in and like and comment and all that good stuff. So thanks again, Miss Eileen, for sharing that. We appreciate it. I also want to share Tim Arthur has one. Really, it's kind of just getting ready for yesterday night's Mad Men premiere. This is season 5. I guess I wish I would have had this earlier. Would have made more of a buzz. But either way, let me share this with you. We talked about the Mad Men event last night, which was great. And he did a great job. Both he and his wife did a great job. And so big shout out to them for making that work. Here's the link. You can check that out. And then last but not least, I wrote an article yesterday. It was another one of those live blogs. It's called Imagine Celebration Weekend. And if you guys are in the area, if you happen to be in the area during Easter weekend, I would definitely encourage you to come on out and hang out with me at C3. All right. Let me share this link with you in the chat room as well. And let me jump into this last story of the day. And I definitely think this is interesting because we talked about this story just weeks ago. You may remember there was a commercial that Microsoft was making. There was a challenge, a kind of a throwdown that they threw to other phone makers, and they said, how fast is your phone and how easy is it to get to the information that you want? And I recall that this guy was kind of going up against these different people saying, okay, find X, Y, and Z. And then you would, or how fast can you take a picture? I think was one of the challenges, right? And so they would say 3, 2, 1, go. And then you're supposed to go to your phone, open it up, take a picture, and then show me that you've done it as quickly as you can. Right? And for the most part, as you can imagine, they're trying to sell the phone, right? And they're trying to say, basically, look, our phone is superior to your phone because it can do these things really fast and get you to the information that you want. And I remember thinking at the time, I was like, but you know what? This is probably not a fair fight because you probably have simplified your phone in just a way where all you had to do was click a button and take a picture. I mean, you're almost setting up the deck to win the fight.
Yeah.
You know, it to me, it's just kind of like that's not really a fair fight. But and again, I told you the story about the vacuum clean guy who came into my house and vacuumed my floor and then said, can your vacuum do that? And of course, what he did was he says, you vacuum your floor first and I'll come behind you and vacuum and see if I still pick up stuff. And then, of course, what I said was, I said, well, let me pull out my vacuum and go after your vacuum and see if I pick up stuff. And of course, I did. Right. It's just what happens. So anyway, in this story today, there's actually an Android guy that beat the Windows people, and he was supposed to win like a reward, a laptop, $1,000 special edition laptop that was promised to him if he can beat the challenge, and he did. However, the Microsoft people said, no, you didn't win. You didn't win because, and they came up with some crazy excuse. Yeah.
No way.
Yeah, pretty much. So he won in the in-store challenge, but Microsoft failed to acknowledge the win and did not give him the $1,000 laptop that he should have won. He was using the phone Galaxy Nexus. I throw that in there.
Yeah.
It was the Samsung Galaxy Nexus, by the way.
Get that phone.
And he put it up against there, and he says, this is the author, the blogger who actually wrote this. He says that he put it up, and he was supposed to say, can you pull up the weather in two different cities within 3 seconds? Which, in this challenge, was much faster than when the Windows phone guy could do it. And the guy, the blogger, basically said, look, I already had sort of an application on my desktop that would do that. So when they said go, 3, 2, 1, go, I just went to my desktop app, you know, unlocked it, went to the app, and boom, I pulled up two different cities. Well, when the Microsoft people said, no, you have to do two different cities in two different states. Well, you didn't say that as a part of the,
that
right?
Is
you didn't
cheering.
Say that. Exactly. You should have said that. And so so at this point, he was like, I'm not going to sit and fuss with you, but I just want you to know I won, and you're not fooling anybody. Which is, you know, again, no surprises here.
And that's what
they're trying to sell a phone.
That's what the web is for.
Right?
They're cheating.
Yeah, and they never even put the video out there. They should have put it out there.
Mm.
But here's the link. If Tim says, I just slap him.
Yep, I'm with it. Rolled up newspaper.
But here's the link to the actual story. You can get all the details on what exactly happened and what was said on both sides. But I find it interesting. I mean, I knew this at the time. I mean, I think phones are you know, this is a competitive phone. I think Android's a competitive phone. The iPhone, and I say this out loud, is a very good phone from what I hear. I've not used it much. I think my fingers were burning after I started touching it. It was like, I'm melting, which is a reference to The Wizard of Oz when water was thrown on the evil witch, by the way.
Just
in case you didn't know what that reference was.
Oh, look at that phone. I want that phone.
Yeah, he's looking at the Galaxy Nexus.
I want that phone.
Yeah, it's like phone porn.
Yes. Pause.
Yeah.
Either that or the Note. I may go with the Nexus S. I may hit the Nexus S.
Microsoft apologized and gave the guy a laptop and a free phone. That's what I heard anyway. So, yeah, I haven't heard all the details since then, but I thought that was interesting. You know, of course, that's kind of you got to make a fuss, right? And you write a blog post and you got 246 comments.
Yeah. You got all the.
And he had 1,300 on another, I think he posted it on Reddit. And he got 1,300
seconds.
Comments on
on
Reddit.
There you go. That's one good
place. So, of course,
to go.
They're going to be like, oh, wait a second. All right, you got us. We'll go ahead and give you that $1,000. Because it's going to cost us more than $1,000 to make up for what you just did.
Tim Martha chimes in. Maybe that phone won't turn itself off.
Oh, Tim.
I see what you did,
Tim.
There,
oh, you
see
were so
what
wrong.
You did there,
that's
buddy.
All right.
Nice.
Nice little poke at the last second.
Yes.
Yeah, I see that. Anyway.
Well done, sir.
Let me say thank you to you guys for hanging out with us today.
60 seconds.
I want to say thank you to Alan Tran, DB Funky, Egoanis, Aaron Clifford, Miss Eileen Smith, Little Bicep's Marianne, Tim Arthur, and Dyslexic in America, and all of you listening live in an archive. Thank you for what you do. We really appreciate you for hanging out with us. Don't forget, we are here every Monday through Friday at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time right here on blogtalkradio.com/DamondNolan. Don't forget, you can also get the higher quality audio over on youtube.com/DamondNolan. And thanks again for making us do what it do. We appreciate you. It's because of you that we are where we are.
In a happy place.
All right, y'all. Have a wonderful Monday. We'll see you guys tomorrow. Until then, Mike Render.
Deuces.
Get back to work.
10 seconds. Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio. Goodbye.